Howdy, how's it going? My name's Davvy Chappy, and long ago in the ancient time of about a year ago, I broke the ancient vow that I once held. A vow to never talk about homebrew because it's dumb and I don't like it. But in my hubris, I spoke the forbidden words. I released the seal and did a video about the most requested homebrew that there ever was, and I did it all for one big, beautiful cowboy voice acting man. God, I hate you so much, baby. But now it seems that the world has shifted once again as Matt Boy Mercerachops has absorbed all of the reviews and criticism aimed at his brainchild and crafted a new version of his overly edgy class, the Blood Hunter. So, as always, keep in mind that a lot of this is just my opinion, as I teach you how to be the bloodletter you were born to be. So, the Blood Hunter is the fighter that plagues the nightmares of things that nightmares are made of. A secret order of monster hunters who've unlocked the powers of sorcery via hemomancy, the study of blood magic, unlocking frightening powers beyond that which mortals can provide. As a Blood Hunter, you are born of the blood, made men by the blood, undone by the blood. That's the wrong script. But Blood Hunters do take inspiration from the archetype of the Lone Wanderer, wielding unexpected and arguably evil powers that shun them from normal society, all the while protecting them from that which they'll be blessed never to know about. These are stories like Bloodborne, The Mandalorian, and The Witcher.
Especially The Witcher.
As a party member, your role will be largely similar to that as a fighter, except that you can't use shields and a lot of your abilities cause you to hurt yourself, so you're squishier and not meant to be a stalwart defense against enemies. Rather, you can think of yourself as a fighter that thinks shields are uncool and took the magic initiate feat to gather some gimmicks, and that should give you a decent idea of how you're meant to perform. When you're out on the field, your ass-kicking ability comes primarily from two avenues of power. The blood maledicts, dark omens that you put upon your enemies that seep into their bloodstream and rot them from the inside out, and crimson rites, the ritual of infecting your weapons with some of your own vitality so that you can pound enemies with magical elemental damage. Both of these things make you adept at both melee and ranged combat, fighting in a sort of grungy, back-alley sort of way where you'll either have the right tool for the job, or you'll crack your knuckles, charge in, and throw down. Since the Blood Hunter fancies itself the fighter's edgier cousin, you'll be getting the classic martial abilities like an extra attack and your own unique fighting style, but you'll also get a bunch of new flavors of fighting, and every flavor will taste like blood. You can brand people with blood, bind people with blood, bolster your blood to run faster, and get more blood into your brain so that you can fight harder, strengthen your resolve to protect from mental invasions, fight so many monsters that you just start understanding dark histories before you even hear about them, and bring your opponent's blood to bear by mastering the dark arts for which you are so well known. The Blood Hunter is a smart fighter, the enhancement only serving to add more tools to the arsenal, but it is during the hunt that you truly fear the witch. Never mind. And early on in your career, when you first begin hunting your bloods, you get the option to join one of the Blood Hunter archetypes, in this instance called Orders. There's the Order of the Ghost Slayer, the Order of the Profane Soul, the Order of the Mutant, and the Order of the Lycan. First up, the Order of the Ghost Slayer represents the very group of BHs that took a look at a hemophiliac and thought,
we can do something with that.
Ironically, the oldest Order of the Blood Hunters happens to specialize in hunting the only monster that doesn't actually have blood in it, but never mind. When you swear in yourself to slaying all things that walk through walls, disappear, and fly, you gain your own anti-ghost abilities, such as an enhanced blood maledict that hurts ghosts now, the power to turn ethereal yourself, a crimson rite that binds otherworldly beings to the corporeal realm, a blood exorcism, and you can suck the blood right back into your body before you die to instead stand at the very brink of death. The Ghost Slayer is what you would consider to be the archetypical Blood Hunter. All of your features just buff up your core playstyle to help you do what you do best, which is attack things with wild abandon and then get killed by Lorenzo. Up next, the Profane Soul is a noticeable departure from the traditional Blood Hunter play, created for those players that flipped a coin on whether they wanted to play a Blood Hunter or a Warlock, and the coin landed sideways. Striking up a bargain with the otherworldly patrons for which the Warlock is known, Blood Hunters act as a half-caster, but instead of borrowing from the Wizard or Cleric spell list, they use the limited but powerful arcane prowess of the Warlock, granting them the Warlock's faucet method of,
I can't hit you often, but when I do, you're gonna bleed really, really hard.
Depending on who your arcane pimp daddy-in-law happens to be, you'll be gifted a whole slew of new powers to exercise your right to slay, including enhancements to your blood maledict, learning how to cast and fight fluidly like an eldritch knight, gifting new spells to your spell list, leaving arcane scars etched in the blood of your enemies, and gaining new spells that you don't have to spend a spell slot for, which is a huge bonus for warlock stands. Your final ability lets you point at any living creature and say, "Your soul is mine," and then absorb them to gain power-ups and potentially even another warlock spell slot. Overall, this class makes you a weird, edgy Eldritch Knight that will typically influence you to go more ranged, but without the innate ability to purchase the DLC for Eldritch Blast like the Warlock can, you'll be fine just picking up more physical spells and rushing in like the bloody twink you are. Now, if purchasing on-disc DLC is something you are into, then might I direct your attention to the Order of the Mutant, a sect of scientists that have listened to the Jekyll and Hyde musical so many times that they convinced the Bloodhunter organization to give them funding for their own musical, under the guise of it being morally questionable bioengineering of dubiously willing test subjects. You can't fool me, I know a theater kid when I see
see one.
When you go down the path of the mutant, your body becomes a playground for mutagens, strange alchemical potions that provide powerful advantages at the cost of an equally powerful disadvantage, proving once and for all that science has no place in D&D. As you grow your tenure, you'll discover more formulas for mutagens and be able to hold on to more at a time. You'll also put so many poisons into your body that it'll be like, fuck this, and just become immune to them all. You can use your blood brand to force people to reveal their true nature, and you'll eventually spend so much time being a bioalcoholic that you'll unlock the greatest bender power of them all. The power to mix drinks and not have an upset stomach afterwards. With all of these powers combined, you will become a masterful force, able to not only slay monsters in all of their forms and permutations, but also do it while completely hammered. If you're looking for a subclass that gives you a lot of Batman-esque, always having the right tool for the job style gratification, the Order of the Mutant will keep you chugging those 40s. And finally, if you were looking for a way to really become the monster that fights monsters, the Order of the Lycan did what the Mutant Club down the hall did, but instead of theater kids, they're furries. Abandoning all reason, the Order of the Lycan decides that the best way to hunt down monsters is to inject themselves with lycanthropy as a way to justify all that brooding at the moon. Lycan bloodhunters will typically do this as an extreme form of know your enemy, as their typical hunting target happens to be lycanthropes that have gone bad, and they are so fervent in their devotion to the Lycan curse that they will go to any length to ensure that it is not dispelled from them. And if it is, they damn well go back to their furry daddy and get some more of that lycan juice. The Order of the Lycan revolves around one main gimmick, this being a hybrid shift that gives you a bunch of power-ups, but comes with the drawback that if you get booped in your snoot too many times, you run the risk of going psycho and attacking everything around you. As you get stronger, so too will your hybrid form until you become the ultimate master of the fursuit, and you'll unlock other animal-themed abilities along the way, like having keener senses, jumping higher and further, figuring out how to control your homicidal outbursts, and being able to perform a blood-curdling howl, which is the biggest stretch of blood magic I've seen since Castlevania. As a subclass, the Order of the Lycan transforms the Bloodhunter from a think-on-your-feet, any-size-fits-all type of slugger into a pseudo-barbarian that somehow has even more anger issues. If you want to abandon tact and rip and tear into every enemy you see, then when it comes to Bloodhunter orders, who can? Lycan. But that'll about do it. I hope you enjoyed this video. Be sure to ring that notification bell so that you can stay up to date on all of your Davvy news, and maybe toss a like, comment, subscribe, all that YouTube jazz. And if you want to be a cool dude, maybe support me on Patreon so that I can keep my entire life revolving around D&D. I hope you enjoyed, but yeah, Davvy out.